I'm in South Australia, where winter has arrived early, blowing gale-force winds in what was supposed to be summer. The seas have been wild and impossible to dive in, and I'm worried that the leafy sea dragon, the weird creature I so desperately want to see, will forever remain a mythical creature. But overnight, the wind has dropped, and Carrie and I have to make the most of this window in the bad weather.
Oh, to be a fish.
There's lots of these little old waves down here. These are cool little fish. Hang around in groups. And they grind their teeth when they're caught. Apparently they sound like old women grumbling. Pretty little fish though, they're probably the most visual fish down here.
Leafies have relatively small territories, rarely bigger than 10 metres squared. But the recent violent currents and tides means that the sea dragons could have been carried anywhere along this coast. Once out of their eelgrass habitat, they're vulnerable. That's if they've survived the power of the storm.
Oh my goodness me!
But then Kerry points out what initially looks like a clump of seaweed, but in fact, it's an old friend.
I'd like to introduce you to Max. This is one of my dragons that I've been following.
That is just one awesome fish. It's hard to believe it's a fish at all. I was expecting a much harder run. I thought we were going to be swimming around for hours before we actually saw one. We're right underneath the jetty practically.
Yeah, he's a long way out of his territory. I was expecting to find him much further out than what we are. To find him in the shallows like this is incredible.
Kind of lost for words. It is one of the most ornately flamboyant animals I've ever set my eyes on. Just absolutely exquisite. Hardly looks like a fish at all, and I guess that's the whole idea. You can kind of see the seahorse in it, but all these sort of flaps and flanges, these billowing flags, I guess, just take it to another level. Oh my goodness me. I'm quite happy with Max. I can't believe I'm actually here finally looking at a dragon. It seemed for a while there we weren't even going to get in the water.
The leafy is real. It does exist, unlike its mythical namesake. And you can see where the dragon part of the name comes from. It looks every bit like a Chinese dragon.
How old is Max?
We found Max in August of 2007, so he's only about 2 years old now.
That's pretty impressive. I mean, is this as big as they get, or do they get bigger?
They actually do get bigger. Max is about 16 to 18 inches long. Some actually get up to 600 millimetres, or about 24 inches or 2 feet long in the old scale.
And look at that, when he goes into the weed, suddenly he vanishes. I think that's the secret with the dragon. It's all about context. When you see them out in the open, they're very obvious. As soon as they move into the weed, they vanish. I have got so many questions for those folks back in the museum.
I would say that the sea dragon is an uber specialist, the leafy. It's so perfectly adapted to basically hiding in kelp.
A very particular kind of kelp as well.
Looks just like it. I mean, I'm amazed if you can see the guys. So many people, you know, they just don't see them. They're just beautifully camouflaged. And yes, that does mean if they swim out into open water, they're toast. So they have to stay in that area, and they become. It's like a reinforcement. You know, you're specialized. You're living in a certain place. You want to get better and better and better and better and better, and you end up, as you say, you're in a corner.
Yeah,
now,
you're backed into a corner.
In evolutionary sense, that ain't no corner. That's a great place to be. But of course, when humans come on the scene and we start disrupting the system, we start taking kelp away, we start impacting that very, very special kind of environment. The problem is the accelerated rate of change that humans have brought to the picture. So yeah, the poor sea dragon may well be a victim of its own success.
The only fishy bits, I guess, that are obvious, and even then not that obvious, are what's causing this animal to be able to very subtly manoeuvre around in the water. But on the back there, you can see the dorsal fin pulsating away. That's pretty much this fish's only mode of propulsion. The other two fins that it has are either side of the head. They look a bit like ears. They're the pectoral fins, and they can kind of turn them on and turn them off. They don't do that, but they sort of vibrate, pulsate, as it were. And by just subtle alterations of different fins, the dragon can maneuver itself around. I guess it's a bit like flying a helicopter. Means that these fish really, really are difficult to remove from the wild. So despite the desire to have one in a fish tank, I can't imagine ever removing a fish like this from its habitat. It belongs here.
Come and have a look up close at the tail. You can actually see the dimples on the bottom of the tail here from this year's brood, where the eggs have hatched and left the dimples behind.
So Max may have fathered as many as 250 babies this year. And as we're returning to the jetty, I spot another leafy, which turns out to be Max's partner.
Whoa. Michelle, you beauty. This is Max's girlfriend. We lost her 4 months ago. Hello, gorgeous. She's a little bit older, so that way she's a little bit thicker and a bit chunkier in the body too. So glad we found her. It's great to see that she's still alive.
If Kerry's right that Max has had babies this year, then finding Michelle, his partner, means that there's an even greater chance of us finding the juvenile leafies.
So that's my first dragon, the first one I spotted anyway.
Well, we've got to protect this area, because if we don't have this, we don't have dragons.
But our air is running out, so if we want baby dragons, they'll have to wait until the next dive.
Well, we got our dragons. Absolutely fantastic. I know you can't see it, but I'm smiling from ear to ear. Kerry, thank you very much. That's brilliant. Absolutely fantastic.